Got some cool extracts coming in there. Here's the rest of it. Condensing some really cool stuff here. It's collecting really well. Is that vanilla frosting?
Vanilla frosting.
Another thing is the column's clean. It needs to be set up so we can run it. Extractor's good. Nothing crazy going on. Separating some fats here. Fatty waxiness. Couple experiments here. Oh, look, some weed. Oh, that looks nice. For joints? Hell yeah. Oh, man. Looking mighty fine. I don't know what this is. Okay.
What's up, everyone, and welcome down to another episode of Zetro's Toxic Vault. I am your host, Steve Zetro Souza, and today, well, I've already been stoned all day, but we're going to be stoned through this episode today because we are going to be talking cannabis, and my guests today are Mr. Alex Lopez and Mr. Emmanuel Duarte. Good to have you both in.
Thanks for having us.
And these guys actually don't necessarily grow the weed. They are like the chemists, scientists that kind of extract it. So I know some of you like to smoke the pens or like to smoke the oils or like to do the dabs and the stuff like that. Well, these guys, they're kind of the guys that are the brains on the chemistry behind that, and they're going to be talking to us about it. Thanks for coming in, guys.
Hell yeah.
Well, all the guys know, all the fans know that I'm a stoner. I've been a stoner my whole life since I was 12 fucking years old, and I'm 57.
Amen.
So
amen to
I've
that.
Smoked weed all, the whole time. I smoke weed during my show. I'm always reaching out to the stoners. When I go on tour, the stoners come to kick me down, and which I will thank you guys all for that. And you can always, gummies, doesn't matter, just give them to me and I'll take them. But my guests today, these guys actually get down to the science of it all, and we're going to talk about that today. So good to have you in, Alex. Good to have you in.
Such a pleasure. I really appreciate the invitation.
And, no problem.
I just love talking about weed. I mean, it's a crazy thing.
Now, how did you get into like the end of becoming the chemist part of it? I mean, there's growers, right?
Yes, yes.
And I'm sure they know their own science, but you guys actually extract it, and you guys pull the CBD out of it and the THC. And then how did you get into that?
Well, we'll start with a little background of me. There was dispensaries that were popping open. I was about 19 years old, 18 years old. And honestly, when I was smoking it, and one of my early, I say dealers, but he was just a friend, you know what I mean? He's a friend with weed, basically, is what I call him. And what happened was he was doing like the old school, I say old school, but now for us, it's the old school method of like butane blasting, where you just put it in a glass tube, you blast it with a canister.
I remember with that butane
blasting.
People
were blowing themselves up and shit. It became a huge problem. But we didn't know any better. We were just like, whoa, check this out. And I remember the first time I saw like a dab, that was just a whole nother level of crazy. But basically, I bugged some people at a local dispensary, and the local dispensary, there was a girl there who was managing, and she's like, you know what? I think you'd be good for this. She just thought I could have a rapport and talk with people. And I think she maybe saw some of my interest, that it wasn't just all about getting high to me. It was like, I really wanted to understand, what the fuck is this? What is this? Where did this plant come from? How does it affect us? And then after that, we had actually an on-site extraction at this dispensary that I was working at. And so I would see the guy walking by, and I was like, hey, I want to learn more about this. Do you have any openings? Do you have it like somewhere where I could start
like an internship.
Yeah, basically.
Now, is this guy an actual chemist, or is a guy who's just been working with pot for years?
He was someone who was a hash maker for about 10, 15 years, and then
kind
was,
of the same process, right?
Yeah, yeah, that's the earliest extractions. And apparently, when I dig into the history of cannabis, they say that people were smoking hash before they smoked flower. Like the old Afghani and Moroccan hash was a lot of like running through fields, just grabbing it on hands, and they would stuff those into pipes. I think they discovered tobacco before maybe smoking cannabis. Because cannabis was just rope. It was just utility for such a long time.
Sure.
Yeah, it was just like pretty much it. But let's get into some of your background.
How did you get into it, Emmanuel? Same way?
Oh, I've had this passion for a long time. It's been over 12 years in the making now. But I was living in Florida where it was very illegal. And I had a mom who was very conservative and wanted nothing to do with it. The first time I told her I even smoked weed, she just slapped me across the face.
Wow.
So all of that started from me trying to get more informed, becoming as knowledgeable as possible, so that whenever she would say some stupid shit like marijuana is a gateway drug, or you're gonna go, you know, you're gonna become addicted, or, you know, stupid shit like that, I would be able to refute it with, like, you know, scientific evidence or, you know, just proof. So there I got my bachelor's in science, in agriculture science, and then basically I ended up as an extractor through failing growing. I wanted to be a grower. I wanted to learn all about the science of farming.
So damn
but they threw me into, you know, it's easy when it's like 10, 15 plants. Yeah. They threw me into a field with 3,000 plants and three people managing it.
Trial by fire.
And it was like different tiers. So it was like this crazy like elevation, and it was like 115 degrees in this Oregon Valley. And I was living on the farm, so it was like 11-hour days. 6 days a week, and then on Sunday, hey, Sunday's your chill day, don't worry about it, we'll take care of the other stuff, but can you water the greenhouse? It's like 4 hours to water the fucking greenhouse. Yeah. So
well, it's a chill day compared to the 11 hours, I guess.
Exactly, right? Yeah, so on a farm.
I got a hernia, but I also had a hernia on the farm, and I'm like, okay, this is not for me. I had a background in microbiology and chemistry, and I figured, just send out a resume, and somebody wanted me. I had the cannabis experience, I had the science experience, and then it all kind of came together. And then that's where I met Alex at Bright Labs.
Yeah, we worked in a different lab together. That's
pretty
where we
close
first
to this spot also.
Yep.
And we were using CO2 extraction, and then but we didn't really get into the real science of it. We were basically like workhorses.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
There, we were just like pushing material through this big ass machine that runs for 18 hours and, you know, it pulls out all the terpenes and the cannabinoids,
right?
And but it's also very fatty. So like we would see this crude extract, and it looked like shit. It looked it was like fat, literally fat.
Yeah, it looks like orange, like pumpkin orange guts or something.
Really,
like,
fat.
It's, yeah,
and water,
yeah, and water, lots of water, because that's what's inside the actual like stem material, the leaf material. Like when they test, if you look at these testings, I mean, if you, a bud is like at the highest spectrum, like 31-33% THC, right? Or cannabinoids even. That would mean that one third of that whole nug is just get you high fun stuff. But then the rest of it is, yeah, it's fats, it's water, it's lipids. And this is what the fun of extraction becomes.
Because every single extraction method has its pros and cons. CO2, you have to run it for 18 hours. Now with the extraction method that we have, we only run it for 15 minutes.
Yeah, maybe like a few
but
minutes.
It's a liquid solvent compared to this super critical CO2.
Safer for the consumer and for the
CO2 is actually incredibly safe. It's literally it's like the shit that is in the atmosphere, and then they compress it and they heat it, and it turns into this something called a supercritical fluid. Yeah. So it runs through this material and it extracts the cannabinoids like a liquid, but it off gases, you know. So there's really no residual solvents in that process. But then they put it in, then they dissolve it in ethanol, so that they have to go through a purge process anyway.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I never really understood CO2 for that reason.
Because
you might as well just use chemicals from the beginning.
Right.
It's easier, it's better, it's faster.
Now, if you go to a dispensary and you'll buy a product, you'll buy weed, and it'll say 28% THC or 34% THC, is that what you're saying? Is like the third of the plant?
Yes.
Is going to get you high, but the rest of it isn't. So,
yeah, even I say 30%. That's including.
That's a lot.
That's including. It's a lot. That's what I'm saying. On the highest number, that's a lot. That's when I think about it, and you look
that's
at it.
That's unnatural. That's like comparing it to like
I got one the other day. It was
37%.
That's fucking crazy. What the fuck?
37%.
That's yeah. That's so unnatural. Like if you see these plants out,
they don't endorse me, so I'm not gonna say what company they are.
Dude, not yet.
But those buds are so big that those plants are literally like falling over. Yeah. It's like those GMO chickens that like literally can't stand up because they're so fat. It's like. But that's where genetics is going. That's like where the that's what the consumer wants. It's all about the numbers.
Well, yeah, so exactly. I mean, when I hit it, doing. I wanted to go bang. So
yeah.
Now you deal with farmers, or yeah. You have to deal with it now. You have to deal with legal farmers, correct?
Yes, of course. Yes.
And so they've been licensed through the state of California and all that, and everything that they bring in to you guys is probably logged and to the
gram.
Farthing. Seed to sale is what they call it. Yes. And so there's a bureau now in California specifically called the Bureau, the BCC, Bureau of Cannabis Control.
Oh, you told me about those guys.
Yeah. No one's ever seen them. We've worked at several companies. We have lots of friends.
That's the most interesting thing about them is that I'm sure someone's cutting checks to them. But no one's ever seen those motherfuckers. Yeah.
And they're alcohol.
Really?
None of us. I mean, there are regulators I've heard that come down, but they're like in the form of OSHA.
OSHA and the fire department are the two pain in the asses here because they know that this industry is a little sketchy.
Yeah.
Because it's, you know.
How strict are they with you guys, like in your lab and that sort? Are they doing monthly inspections? Because they just knock on the fucking door and go, okay.
That's exactly
We're coming in.
That's exactly
And we want to look around. And we want to do you have this? And get your logs and all your shit.
Well, from my experience, that hasn't been the case. They usually send an email. And then sometimes, and now, especially with COVID, it's been so easy to just like deflect that. Hey, you can't just come in here.
Yeah, in the law, they have it written in that they can do that. It's a very...
I'm sure they do.
Yeah, with legalization, it was a very, like, a lot of us in the industry who were really paying attention to the legality and the laws, and I was down there in Oakland lobbying, you know, for, like, reduce our taxes, or tax us properly. Tax us to the point where, like, you know, we can use banks, because that's the most dangerous thing about the industry is that we can't use banks. We can't use bank accounts. So, like, I've been in an armed robbery at a dispensary before.
So armed cars don't come and pick up all the cash?
No.
Who does?
It's us. It's dumbasses like us, dude. Fucking idiots like
hell
us.
Hell yeah, I'm going to rob your dumb ass. I'm going to bring a gang.
I look so robbable, dude.
I mean, because you're thinking, man, in the 15 minutes I'm there, I see the amount of money that each register's doing. In the 15 minutes let alone...
At a dispensary, they usually have an armed security guard.
But they do? Okay.
But picking up.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to say, okay. We had armed security.
Did you see that movie with Jason Statham recently? Come on now.
Yeah.
We come in like that, pal. That armed guard ain't doing shit.
That flick. He's not paid to do shit either, honestly.
I know. Think about it.
Look intimidating.
You start pulling out guns and say, I'm robbing this place. I'd be like,
oh, okay.
You're on your own, bro. And the money's right. There's a cash machine right around the corner. Check it out. You unplug that motherfucker. Take it with you. Fuck that.
They know, and those were my favorite security guards. Were the crazy ones, the ones who were like, no, I show up with my AR and I got real plates, and I got like the guys who are like, I feel so much safer when your crazy ass is here as opposed to most of them who know how dangerous it is and definitely feel I don't know nervous most of the time. But like that's a big thing that I've always lobbied for. Like that keeps the employees safe, the employers safer. You know what I mean? And it stops because that does happen to a lot of different companies, and specifically there's dispensaries here that are literally right off the freeway that have been unfortunate targets multiple times, and I think that's like a big deal. Yeah, keep these guys safe, keep the employees safe, and then all of a sudden that cash is gone because we weren't able to transfer it properly.
Right, exactly. Yeah, because there wasn't
any. And then banks, they pay.
That's going to get figured out real quick. It's already figured out, but I'm sure it's going to get even more so figured out. Because one armed guard, you know what I mean? Some guy dressed like you goes into walking and, what's up, man? Grab him, put him some hold. Three guys jump out of a car all masked, and he's done. They're walking in and they're taking all the weed, all the money, give it to me. Who's going to be in there?
Honestly, the vans, I probably shouldn't be saying this shit. Vans are probably easier to rob because. It's just idiots.
Yeah, it's
you heard it here first.
You heard it here first, yeah.
He's just being honest. What I love about the vault is we only tell the truth to you guys. And there's two guys that are in the industry.
It's fucked
and
up. We got to figure it out.
That's the way it is. You know what I mean? Because the newity of it all, there's a fucking huge gray area there.
There is.
You know what I mean? And I mean, that goes from Because, I mean, I have been smoking pot quite some time. We've talked about that. And I know guys that...
Cheers, fuckface. Yeah,
and then I know guys who still play black market because they say that the guys that are doing it legal are losing their ass because of the protocol from seed to fucking shiny seed. You know what I mean? They got to count every stem. It's got to be disposed away. They can't use pesticides. They can't. It's a fucking plant. You know, what are you supposed to do? So, I wonder, is that a challenge that you're hearing from the growers that you're dealing with?
Absolutely. Everyone, not just growers, from every single person in this industry. Just sales are just generally down because shit's expensive because it's taxed so heavily.
Yes, so.
And, the distribution fees in between every single step. If you go from one place to the next, the distributor, whoever brought it there, is taking 10-15%. To bring it to you, and then for you to get it to the dispensary, and then the dispensary doubles it, and then they do the state tax after that, which is 30%.
So he had a really good point that we spoke about before about, like, kind of on the business side of things, distribution. That's what legalization has created, a huge, huge industry of people who really don't care, who don't even, I mean, like, they're not supposed to. They're just really good logistic people. So these are logistic companies. They have a license to hold the product. Like, we can't hold the product. We can because we do have a distribution license at Chemistry, trychemistry.com.
And that's the company, by the way.
That is Chemistry. The company,
Chemistry. Really, a little shameless brand.
I know we should have been. I'm just saying, hey,
it's my fault.
We're smoking weed. It's Alex and Emmanuel here. We're having a great time.
We're just eyeing.
Hey, where you guys from? Oh, yeah, you guys are the weed guys. Yeah, that's right. Fuck it. Fuck
Who are you in, man?
Well, here, hit this. We don't care. We're doing a show? Yeah, fuck yeah. Here we are.
So, so Chemistry, that's we're fortunate enough to have a distribution license, which allows us to hold product for ourselves and other companies.
Yep.
So, like, a lot of companies are making money off, like, contract stuff like that, producing bulk for other companies or distributing, like, being able to move it from place to place up and down California. That's a ton of money. Like, that is a huge booming industry. I mean, there's big warehouses around California that there are, like, Walmart, Amazon size warehouses with forklifts and everything, stuff that is 16 wheelers, parking lots, and I'm just like, wow. I've seen some of them and just been like, this is a whole new industry right here.
Ooh, it's brand new. I mean, to get in now is really getting in on the, even if you got in now, you're getting in the early stages of, it's like, think about like what beer turned into, you know what I mean? And eventually, in probably 20 years, Budweiser's gonna have their own fucking line of weed, you know, just because they have the money to put into it to get the fields.
It's still gonna be called Budweiser.
It's gonna be it's gonna be called Budweiser.
Just Budweiser.
Yeah, but I mean that, and somebody actually told me, and I heard that they had bought a whole bunch of you know, property and fields to start getting into this industry because it's gonna be the next thing, which it already is.
And they've had it for probably like a decade now, probably 8 to 10 years. They've had those, and they probably run them regularly, but then they just probably destroy everything so that there's no hint that they've done the research. You're right.
Like a fucking rain cloud.
I have every reason to believe that, yes, they're doing the research as well to keep up. They're maintaining their knowledge because that's what a big, large company does, how you keep tabs on your competitors just so you're not out of touch with the market. You know what I mean? That's absolutely happening with them. Pabst Blue Ribbon. That's funny you said that. Pabst Blue Ribbon just released a seltzer weed.
Like, really? Water. See, that's backdooring their way in. We're going to take a break right now to go to some of our sponsors. We will be back with Emmanuel and Alex, and we are going to talk about the process of what it takes to actually extract the weed and turn it into the crystalline and the cool little pens and little pods that just all the fun stuff that we do. When we come back on Zatros Toxic Vault. What's up, everybody? And you want to know where you can go to get your Zatros Toxic Vault official merchandise? Go to seasonofmist.com. They're in the United States and they're in Europe. Check this out. Pretty killer, huh?
Go to seasonofmist.com and get your Zetros Toxic Vault stuff today. All different types of sizes, all different types of shirts, all different types of prints that you could have them on, put on custom your way. So go to seasonofmist.com today. What's up, everybody? Zetro here, and you know I like hot sauce. If you're a metal guy, you're probably your burrito guy, because I know all the Exodus guys love to eat Mexican food and love to eat hot food. Well, I have an amazing sponsor for our show, Hella Hot Hot Sauce. They make all different kinds of flavors that actually a lot of their flavors sponsor different musicians or DJs or have different themes to them. You can go to hellahothotsauce.com. They got mild stuff, they got medium stuff, and they got really good hot stuff. It's good, burn your tongue right off your fucking mouth stuff. So go to hellahothotsauce.com and get some hot sauce today.